Yeah.
I'm very glad to
join
webinar. Can you hear me?
Introduce you at the beginning, then you can begin your
presentation. Yeah, Mr. Mathi, please, yes.
Yeah. On behalf of Jajan Institute of Management and Mass Communication, I welcome Dr. Sarala Gopalan. Dr. Gopalan has had a very illustrious career as a top bureaucrat of this country. As an IAS officer in Kerala, she did a lot of experiments. In fact, as a district magistrate and collector, she created a model village, which is talked about even today. Later, at the Government of India, as secretaries to different departments, to Human Resource Development, Women and Child Development, and many other organizations, she put her developmental cap on and did lot many policy initiatives. And after her retirement, she has been headlong into the developmental sector and has been doing developmental advocacy for last several years. And that makes her a unique person to discuss the subject today. In today's topic is extremely relevant. Only the other day, Prime Minister said, the government has no business to be in business. That's a right statement. How can government is supposed to be a referee? How can a referee become a player? But what is the alternative? Do we go back to a situation where the untrammeled free market creates a condition like in Putin's Russia, where there are only a few capitalists, where the crony capitalism has taken roots? Or do we go back to a China model? Command, state-commanded private economy, but China is an authoritarian setup and we are a democracy. Can we become a Scandinavian model, possibly, which is much more egalitarian? Can we have a system where we only have a government taking care of our education, health, and other basic amenities and leave the rest to the private sector? There are different developmental imperatives right from Nehruvian era. Today we are in the Modi era. What would be the optimum objective, optimum solution for India's developmental crisis is something which we need to discuss. And that is what Dr. Sarala Gopalan would be reflecting on. Welcome, Dr. Gopalan.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohanty. I had very little notice, but since I live with this idea of development, I shall prioritize on the thoughts that come to me right now at this moment, considering the present status of our social, economic, political environment, and see how best we can steer through this and give some pleasant time to our people who have gone through a lot of miseries just in the recent years. Forget about the burden of poverty they have been carrying all through. But that poverty has been made even more miserable with the present developments that have taken all over the world in terms of the COVID pandemic and the slowdown of our economy and the various world developments which have also impacted India. And consequently, we are not able to find the basic needs of people, incomes for them to survive and meet their basic needs. Therefore, this topic on the imperatives, identifying India's development imperatives, is very urgent. And I said, please say it has to be a very flexible approach. India is a very vast country with different regions defined by different parameters, by shortage of resources or abundance of resources that cannot be exploited because of lack of capital, because of lack of technology, because of skills, a lot of matters. Therefore, it is important for us to adopt a very, very flexible approach and then see what will work best in a particular area for a particular group of people. For instance, the greatest misery we all watched on our TV sets, sitting cozily in our drawing rooms, where the effort of the migrant labor who traveled thousands of kilometers from their homes to seek their bread and butter in distant parts of this own country, which were flourishing or not flourishing, but were performing slightly better in construction industry, in tourism, in hospitality, and whatsoever. In fact, special trains were bringing them from Guwahati to Trivandrum, from various parts of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, West Bengal, Orissa, to deep southern parts. I was so amazed one day, almost 10 years ago, sitting in a hut in the coast of Kerala, in a village in Thrissur, where I had gone to do a survey on household energy. I was talking to the head of the household on his fuel collection and looking at the big store he had created of the coconut residues for being used for the whole year to burn and cook food in his home. I heard people talking Oriya. I said, how come Oriya being spoken in this remote coastal village of Thrissur? Then my guide who had taken me there said, ma'am, you do not know this. Today all construction labor comes into Kerala from outside, other states, from Orissa, from Jharkhand, from Uttar Pradesh. And then I started noticing a little more carefully. And then, you know, you go into a tea shop, you talk in Hindi, because all the servers there are from Uttar Pradesh or Bihar, largely Bihar and even West Bengal. So it's been a mixture, a cultural mixture with people looking for better life or at least better incomes. I won't say much better life, but something better than they could get in their own homes because there was no way of earning any income if they stayed back in their villages. After all the trouble when they came so far, once COVID struck, all enterprises closed, all economic activities closed, and most people were not able to get any food. They were turned out of their shelter. We saw those scenes in Delhi where the rooms they had rented had to be vacated because they could not pay rent there because there was no income and they had no food. And in this miserable condition, without any transport immediately at command to take them back to their homes, many of them walked. We saw army of people walking along the roads of India from Kanyakumari to Patna and beyond to Guwahati, to Jharkhand, to many, many places. And then when they went to their village. They were again in quarantine. They had to be outside because they said, you have come from outside. You may be infecting us, so stay away. There were no beds for them. There were no nurses. There were no doctors, no medicines to take care of them. This was the miserable condition we saw on our television sets day in and day out for almost 20, 30 days. It was much after this long misery that some trains, after a lot of argument as to who would pay the fares, the state government or the central government, and enormous monies being collected from them. They emptied all their savings, and wherever it was feasible, some of the family people sent them money to get onto the train or get onto the trucks. Many died even on the way, some walking on the railway tracks, some on the trucks, meeting with accidents. So many people, maybe, I don't know, government didn't keep account of how many died. Maybe thousands of them died, and crores of them have walked to their homes. This miserable condition comes again and again and again before my eyes, and I feel miserable that we have been not able to do anything about it. The most we could do here and there was feed them for some days in shelters that were created for feeding. But that was no assurance for them for their long term. And therefore, they thought it was better for them to go home and share whatever poverty there was in the family than wait here in anticipation of some prosperity, which was very remote or uncertain. Therefore, that's the imperative, the first imperative, I would say, if you can create the economic environment in their own homes where they stay, so that even if they don't earn three times what they would earn at their village, they will have something to eat and some shelter. Can we make that? That would be the first imperative. We have seen when some water flowed into an arid area and some crop could be cultivated, people stayed back in the village to do cultivation. And then we found this happened right in our memory in the last 15, 20 years. Earlier, all Bihar labor was going to Punjab for doing the harvesting and all the agriculture work. But with some development taking place in Bihar, a lot of these rural migrants stayed back and didn't go to Punjab. Of course, mechanization overtook, and Punjab agriculture got more and more and more mechanized. And even with the Bihar labor not coming in, they could continue their agriculture and flourish there. Recently, some of the employers sent them home in planes and brought them back in plane, flew them back to come and do work in their fields or in their enterprises, because such was the need of their skills in this new area. Therefore, when there is a need, things will happen. And one of the big things, one of the big successful experiments, I would say, we have done through the programs of development in the government of India under rural development is under MNREGA. Earlier years, maybe 5, 6, 7 years ago, MNREGA, they used a criteria for plowing in a lot of that money into creating irrigation, minor irrigation, because minor irrigation assured a lot more agriculture even in less endowed lands. Agriculture developed. This is now happening in Kerala, where uncultivable lands are being put to cultivation. And a lot of women who did not go into the fields and do agriculture are now getting into agriculture and cultivating various kinds of crops, because water has become available in lands that were allowed to dry and waste away. This happened with human effort. That little wage that MGNREGA gives was used for getting people together, dig up tanks and ponds, dig up canals, and drain the water from its major source into these channels and irrigate small pieces of land where people could cultivate and produce for the market and send it to them. Therefore, there are so many opportunities like this which have to be identified. Now, this identification cannot take place by the central government by one order. The central government can order, they can make policies, schemes under their program. But the implementation depends on the people at the ground level. In my experience, I have seen that every one of the scheme will get its meaning if the person at the grassroots level who has to implement it has understood the philosophy of it and is able to get the bunch of authorities around him to help him or her do the program. With the Panchayati Raj coming in, I can reel out names of several panchayats where the panchayat presidents have done miracles with the little schemes that the government of India or the state government have given to them by making their own panchayats flourish very well. First, build the infrastructure. Building one road link to the village and the market will open up huge avenues of employment for the people. To give you one small instance, in Haryana, one village, I took it up for my study, and I found that the entire village was starving because they could not go to the market, labor market in Gurgaon, which was about 15 kilometers away from them, and take up the various daily wage jobs that were available in abundance. Lorry loads of workers were being taken to those spots, but the people of this village could not reach in time. You know, at 6 o'clock, they have to reach that place where the lorry comes to pick up the workers. Now, being in a remote village, 15 kilometers away with no road, they could not walk and reach, and they can neither stay at Gurgaon because they can't afford it. With the result, they were perishing with hunger. Therefore, we understood this and we said, okay, why not do that little road? It was a 5 kilometer road or even less, maybe 3 kilometers. And if that road was done, they could cycle, they could even take carts and go to the bus stand on the main road and reach the point at which the lorry collected the workers to the work spots. So that whole village could supply labor to various areas of construction, factory, other areas where contract labor was being taken on a daily wage. If you see in every city, there is a morning labor market where people are asked to come and join whatever work they like, and they are carried to the spot. But you have to reach the spot. That facility has to be created. It is making one road. Now we'll have to identify. We can't say simply make a road and give an order. That will not work. It has to be a relevant road for the people to carry them from one spot to another. Similarly, such roads have opened up huge markets for the products in the village. In India, we always hear, you know, a lot of tomato, for instance, is grown, and during the best season, they have no way to sell the tomato because they can't reach all the markets in the country in time, tomato being a very perishable article. And they feed pigs, or they just have to plow it back in the land because they can't sell it in the market. And there are times when tomato will sell at 200 rupees a kilo, and other time at hardly 1 rupee or a fraction of a rupee in the markets because so much abundant supply has come. If we can identify these kind of pockets where there is a large quantity of product grown, struggling to reach a market, identify, is it the road? Is it the transportation mode? Is it the marketing agency? Is it the credit that is required or all of it? So that is why I said, you know, we need to have a flexible approach because somewhere maybe a little induction of credit will help them hire vehicles and take them to the market. Somewhere it may be the lack of trucks to take goods to the market. Somewhere it might be the absence of a road which does not enable any transportation to take these goods. That is why our approach has to be very flexible. It has to take in all these different factors and play with them. Coming to government and their schemes, I was just discussing this morning with Dr. Giri, and he was saying, ma'am, there are schemes, but then there aren't allocations. There's no point in government announcing big names and schemes under those big names without providing the money. And sometimes I know, and I have to fight on this in various positions that I have held with my other colleagues, because they make guidelines. The guidelines are so strict that you cannot use the program at all. The other day I had to struggle. My maid said, ma'am, you will be changing my life if only you can help me get a gas cylinder. And we hear everywhere, we are seeing huge hoardings saying that the prime minister is giving gas to all poor households. So she said, I see all these hoardings, ma'am, please get me one gas cylinder because I can't cook my food and come to work on time if I don't have the wherewithal to do it. Poor lady, she had got an electric connection because there was that electric connection in the house she rented, and she was using a ignition stove, but power was not sure. There would be no power when she has to cook her rice. So she said, if I had a gas cylinder and a stove, I can make my food on time and leave the house for my work. So please help me get it. So when we tried to look for it, they said, well, she must have a ration card. She must have an Aadhaar card. I said, okay, let us get her a ration card and an Aadhaar card. They said, oh, then for that, she needs to have a bank account. We went to the bank and we said, can you open an account? This is, where is she employed? What is the permanent source of her income? And where is her ration card? Where is her permanent address? Where is her Aadhaar card? Now, to get each one of this, you have to have the other. To get an Aadhaar card, you need a ration card. To get a bank account, you need an Aadhaar card. Oh, in a vicious circle, we ran around more than 6 months. And then we found that her husband's ration card was in Kerala. And unless she canceled that, she could not get a ration card here in Tamil Nadu where she was living. Now, she could not cancel that ration card and do it here because the authorities in Kerala had set a time when they would cancel old cards and give new cards. Until then, they would not consider any change in the existing cards. That meant a wait for a long time. You do not know when the government agency is going to change this program. I really congratulate the government of India now, where they have said one ration card for the whole country. And if you have get one ration card, you can buy your ration anywhere. I wish this had come 2 years ago. I wouldn't have had to run from pillar to post to help my maid get her gas cylinder connection. So, you know, in all, we are so thoughtless. We government servants, I'm saying, that when we write schemes, we don't link it with all the circumstances we experience in the country and how to make it practical and reachable to every person who needs to use it. Therefore, that is why I always believe that we have got to be flexible. For instance, you know, recently the banks have been struggling with this NPAs, the non-performing assets. What was the definition of a non-performing asset? If you did not repay within an installment that had to be repaid within 3 weeks or 3 months, a stipulated time, then that asset, that loan became a non-performing asset for the bank. Now, when you look at the borrower at the other end, he is not able to sell a good, what he's making, for a multiple reasons. Sometimes it is because his customer who buys these products has not got his credit, or there has been some problem in the market. So he does not get his goods sold, and therefore he does not pay. And when he does not pay, the borrower who is making the goods and sending it to the customer is not able to pay back the bank. And if there is delay in that, then for 3 months, more than 3 months or 3 weeks or whatever the period that is stipulated, that asset is said non-performing asset, and then this person will not get any further loan and he cannot proceed his business. In fact, a huge number of MSMEs have gone through this problem through the COVID times. Government is making programs little by little, but the huge chunk of employment in our MSMEs have not revived fully as they ought to, because all these linkages have still not started working. I think we, you know, the studies, researches have got to be in depth so that you can go and identify the weak links in any long supply chain, repair that link so that that supply chain can work well. It can be for a little screw, or it can be for an aircraft. The problem is the same. You know, one link snaps and the entire supply chain collapses and the business falls. And then it has got such a domino effect that if one business fails, or one supplier, one producer in the link fails, many of the others also fail. We had, of course, a very tiny enterprise. We undertook, as women's enterprise, to make, to assemble radio sets, transistors for the Keltron in Kerala, and similarly other trons in the other parts of the country. They were, the girls who were to do this were given training to put all the different parts, about 224 or 34 parts together, so that the transistor would be made. The first few sets of transistors were made and the girls got their wages. They were very happy. And we said, let us start more units like this, because it is giving so much employment to the educated girls. After they made a certain number of transistors, the company found it difficult to market all the transistors. Now, what they did, they delayed lifting the finished part. In order to buy time, instead of giving 234 parts, they will give 229 parts or 233 parts. One last part, which is important to complete the transistor, will not be given. And if that part is not there, the transistor is not complete. And they will say, now the transistor is not complete, we can't lift it. And these poor girls would have worked all the month, will not get their wages, because all the transistors they have assembled is not being picked up by the agent who has to take all the transistors and pay them the wages. Now, this is what is happening in number of businesses for a variety of reasons. Therefore, one of the imperatives in development is to find out why businesses fail. Most of the time, the intention of the entrepreneur is not to run away with the money. He wants to do an honest business, earn his profit, earn his income. But circumstances do not lead to that. On the one side, we are saying we must make it very easy to conduct business in this country. But I do not know when that is going to happen, because we have not created that conducive environment so that ease of business becomes feasible and possible for every strata of society, from the smallest to the biggest. It is so very essential. I mean, in all my little enterprises for the women, I've experienced so much difficulty in this. I have an absolutely ludicrous case. You know, once we had started a large number of garment stitching units, and women could stitch and they were selling. Once somebody came from London and he said, you know, years ago, there was a very popular movie called Bobby. And in that Bobby movie, the heroine was wearing a particular blouse, which had a belt, and you tied the belt at the waist. And it was a very stylish kind of blouse. So there was big demand. They said, we would like to have a lakh of blouses. Oh, we said, our entire garment industry is going to thrive. And we said, yes, we'll do it. They said, okay, first do the first 2,000 and give us the sample. So the women worked overnight, stitched the first 2,000 blouses, and we sent it to this gentleman in London. He got them. We didn't send all the 2,000. We sent him 100 blouses. But we had completed all the 2,000. Now, after seeing the 100, he said, no, my customers are saying this is not all right. And the order is rejected. Now here, we had enthusiastically made 2,000 blouses and we were sitting on them. And this buyer had refused to take the stock. After that, it took us 7 years to sell those 2,000 blouses. But in the meanwhile, we tried to get money here and there and pay wages to the very poor women who had stitched these blouses. Finally, the savior who bought all these blouses was a very famous social worker in Kerala called Sugatha Kumari. She was chairing the mental hospital and looking after the mental cases of women. And there she found that these women required clothes which they could not tear or remove and throw away. And these bobby blouses became very handy, because the blouse, instead of being tied in the front, if it were tied in the back, the women would not be able to open it easily and throw away the garment. So she said she will buy. Almost 700, 800 blouses she bought and gave the money with which we could pay the wages for these women. So, you know, in designing a development project, there are so many hurdles. And we have to understand the kind of obstacles that can come and see how we can remove them. There are two great ideas, if only that they could be worked on. One was, you know, our former president, Abdul Kalam, he had brought in this idea of Pura, providing urban-like amenities in rural areas. And for that, he had suggested, if you take a 30-kilometer area, and in that 30-kilometer radius, you provide all the facilities, then everybody staying within there can reach a hospital, a school, a shopping center, a factory, a farm, whatever he needs by traveling less than 30 kilometers. So he said, if you could develop this whole country into these bits, into these geographical locations where everything becomes reachable by everybody. I think they experimented in one or two places, but they didn't take the experiment to its conclusion. I think it is still worthwhile, particularly in the context of all those lakhs of or crores of migrants we saw walking back to their villages when their work in the cities were over and they could not get any work. They could not stay somewhere. They could not access medical facilities. There were no beds in the hospital. Why go to rural areas? This happened even in big metropolitan areas. Therefore, the first priority need is to make our primary health centers more equipped with hospital beds so that PHCs are at least in reach of villages. And we have a very large number to cover the entire country. Provide PHCs where they are not, give priority for that. And that, when I say a PHC or a hospital, it means everything. It means doctors, it means nurses, it means equipments, beds, all the paraphernalia that go with a health facility. If we can successfully create that in every nook and corner of the country by using a variety of programs. For instance, MNREGA is providing wage. Just like we used MNREGA to improve irrigation facilities, minor irrigation facilities in some parts, why not use MNREGA even to use for construction of these sheds where you can start, put the beds and give some hospital facility for the rural folk who are deprived of such facility in some parts of our country. Today, everybody has to run up to an urban center to get a hospital bed or to get a qualified nurse or a doctor. Maybe we could keep ambulances which in every place. The Satya Foundation in Hyderabad had done a great job, you know, through the internet linkages, they could identify facilities wherever they were, and a person who was in need of a particular facility could be reached. Either he would be taken to the facility or the facility would go to him. All that this required was the link, internet link, telephone facility to ring up the right people and rush the facility. I think an excellent job was done by the Satya Foundation in Hyderabad. There have been many, many, many such successful efforts all over the country. I think what we need today is to consolidate all those kind of things and then see where we have gone wrong. For in, why I'm against a blanket scheme. For instance, we have the experience of the IRDP, you know, the Integrated Rural Development Program, where for self-employment, loans were being given. And then they calculated that in 3 years, the loan should be repaid and that person should come out of poverty, which meant a 150% rate of return. Otherwise, the person will not be able to pay back the loan and also have enough income to spend. They didn't. Maybe 10% succeeded. 90%, in order to pay the bank, or you know, the cow that was given would get attached because the person who took the loan to buy the cow did not pay the bank back. So the bank would come and take away the cow because the person did not repay the loan given for the cow. Now that person who bought the cow could not sell enough milk to repay the, to live himself, to feed the cow, and then repay the bank the installments that he had to repay within the 3 year period. Consequently, it failed. Subsequently, you know, we made an improvement of this in the Department of Women and Child for the women. We had a program where we could choose 500 women or more at a time, give them training, link them with banks, and also link them with the dairy program. Therefore, all the milk they produced would get collected by the dairy cooperatives. The milk would be taken by the dairy and they would get weekly payments. Therefore, they could buy all the feed for the cow. They could have some income for their personal expenditure, and they could also return the loan to the bank. That way, we created a huge women dairy enterprise, and this has liberated a lot of women from poverty. So what I mean to say is, you know, you need to have the entire linkage in place. You cannot simply give, you know, I'm used an old program of the Central Social Welfare Board where they said, give 5 cows to 5 widows. That was the scheme. Now these widows are all in distant places. They had no wherewithal to give grass to the cow, leave alone cattle feed. And there no way they could sell the cow. They could not even maintain the animal. So we somehow, sometimes, you know, come out with programs that have been issued cannot work. Therefore, we cannot do blanket schemes. Sometimes what happens is some scheme succeeds and everybody wants to do it. We used to joke that the IRDP tea shops. So in a village, everybody would take a loan for a tea shop. Now, if in a village with 1,000 houses, 20 people take loan for tea shops, who will go into the 20 shops? There aren't enough people. Therefore, we have to be very careful in planning what a population can contain, how many tea shops, how many provision shops, and therefore everything needs very careful management inputs, market linkages, and also know how many enterprises of the same kind can thrive in a particular area or particular place according to the offtake of the product of that enterprise. Otherwise, you will end in making surplus that cannot sell in the market. Therefore, it is a very, very delicate balancing act. And in everything, this is required. Now, I would say one of our very successful experiments in the poverty alleviation has been the various programs we have been doing for women under the microcredit system in different parts of the country. The programs in Kerala, particularly the Kudumbashree program, where all these things were very carefully studied. It was studied that look, the most popular saleable product is food. So they did a lot of research. They went into a lot of ethnic food, modern food, then food where they should be sold, which points. Because you can't start a canteen where you have a place to start a canteen without having a clientele who can come to that place. Therefore, you know, earlier we used to do this mistake, create a load center, you know, provide electricity and imagine that all industries will come there. We have very many cases where load centers were created, but development did not take place because other components necessary to make industry thrive in that area were not present. Therefore, you have to be very circumspect in seeing that you have all the requirements. I remember once in a discussion, we were talking about a large number of trucks going to a particular point to deliver raw material and pick up the finished good. Then the chief engineer in Kerala, she said, sir, it's fine. You may find 50,000 trucks, but for these 50,000 trucks, each carrying 20-ton load, you require roads with culverts which can bear the weight, which can carry the weight of the truck with all the goods on it. So until you build your culverts and bridges, you cannot take all these trucks even if your factory starts producing. Therefore, you have to plan. You have to plan the sequence. You have to plan all the issues that need to be tackled. Like, I mean, I could give you thousands of instances where we enthusiastic government officers and governments have failed because we have not been able to think in perspective and understand all the nitty-gritty details of everything. Now that we have so much experience of good and bad, successful and miserably failed enterprises, I think we have to very carefully manage this, but without losing time, and do what is appropriate for each category of people. There is no point in giving cake to somebody who wants gruel to satisfy his or her hunger at this moment. Therefore, we have to understand what is required in a place and what can be provided and what they can consume at that time. Like one time, I remember in Murshidabad, they said, you know, quota for women under IRDP, under Employment Guarantee Program is 30%. So get 30% of women to come and work on the roadworks. Now in that Muslim area, women don't come out to work. So where will you get this 30% quota of women to come and work? You cannot put impossible criteria in a place where it cannot sell culturally. So you have to look at the cultural ambience. You have to look at the economic need. You can't give some facility just because you want to distribute it in an equitable manner in different parts. You have to see whether it will be worthwhile giving it to that community in that place. That is why I'm saying that a lot of homework has got to be done in trying to identify and fulfill identification. We know the very poor have got to be given food. They have also to be given some money so that they can buy their other needs. The little skilled people have to be given opportunity for improving their skills and fitting into areas of new employment avenues by upgrading their skills. So you have to provide the skills. You have to match employment to skills available in an area, and you have to match markets to kind of products that can be manufactured in an area, upgrade those products. Therefore, it is a very complicated, detailed exercise where every kind of technology, skill, management experience, social, what I would say, it is the social awareness, the cultural problems have got to be identified. You know, without taking cultural factors, you cannot be successful in an enterprise. Therefore, you have to look at those sensitive areas. You know, some things are culturally very sensitive, some things are socially sensitive. All of these have got to be kept in mind in trying to do something. Some things change. Like one thing I keep saying everywhere, that the women in Kerala who never came out to work in fields except particular groups of people are now coming out to work in the field, take up any kind of employment they like. So that cultural transformation has taken place, but that takes time. So in the short time, you can't do that. In the long time, maybe you can do, because the best prescription for success is success. If they see success in something, yes, success will bring in more success. Therefore, we have to identify which succeeded in which area for which group of people, and that has got to be introduced in our various development programs. But basic needs like education, skills, health have to be provided. And for that, we have to bring in innovative methods of coordinating various resources from different agencies. I believe in some panchayats, almost 100 crores or 150 crores of rupees become available through various programs. But everything is looked at like through a broken mirror in splits. They are not looked together as in a whole mirror. Therefore, try to make whole mirrors to reflect your resources and needs. Match them. And through that, try to fulfill the imperatives of development for different groups of people in different areas, different economic, political, cultural groups. Only then you can be successful. I think I will stop at this point, and any particular question I can answer or elaborate. Thank you very much.
Sorry. Thank you, Dr. Gopalan, for making a very insightful presentation. I think you gave a perspective which is replete with your experience as an administrator in the government and also with the social sector after you retired from the government. And that's why you gave a lot of examples of certain policies which you had to implement in the government. And later, even as a retired professional, when you had to confront situations where these policies needed to be changed. You made a strong plea for creating a flexible approach. But as you said, that's right, that the government we are a huge country. And if the government makes the approach, every policy framework flexible and leave it to the local authorities to implement, don't you think there would be a much dichotomy and much more contradictory features that will come? And possibly, like you talked about NPA. Yes, that, as you gave examples that 90 days you declare an NPA, you do not consider the kind of problems businessmen face. But think about large, many number of people who are fly-by-night operators. The government possibly makes rules keeping in view the worst beneficiaries of this. Possibly the people who will make the most of it and will in fact abuse the system. But if you make it a flexible approach, possibly those who abuse the system would get a free rein. That's one possibility. So how do you do that detailed exercise? Every district, every village, every panchayat, every state when you are doing a national framework. I think that's a extremely difficult proposition to make but the point that you are making, unless it is decentralized, the policies may become self-defeating. How do you strike a balance? You are mute. Please unmute yourself.
Decentralization is the answer. For instance, I'll tell you, we had given loans for building houses. Now we found that every month you have to give an installment. But the nature of jobs in the rural areas is such that you are not getting a monthly income. Most of the persons in agriculture will get only income after the harvest. Therefore, you have to understand that condition and say, all right, in these cases, you understand when the flow of income would be and give them a little longer period. We did it and we did it successfully. It's a different matter that when the elections came, the politician said, okay, public sector banks have given. This is all government money. You don't have to repay. And even people who are willing to repay were dissuaded from repayment. That's a different thing. but many people, many with the facility of this flexibility of paying when you have the money on hand, repaid the entire amount. So we have to understand the circumstances. So we have to understand what can be delegated and how much can be delegated, and give the authority to make the discretion. That there again, you know, we can't blanket provisions can't be made, but we have to study deeply and say in these cases, okay, this can be made. Still, there will be some exceptions, but many things, if you study, you will come to know what can facilitate.
But ma'am, one argument is that this NPA is piled up only because discretionary power had been given to the bank of managers, that they could roll over all these loans, even if they were aware that all this is being diverted and misused. So, and there could be corruption, nexus as well. So that's the question. The point is the system, abuse of the system by both the recipients and also by the system, by the official themselves, possibly creates a very difficult situation.
No, but then you have your machinery to vigilance, supervision, inspections. I mean, banks are subject to a lot of scrutiny. Those mechanisms have to work very effectively. Otherwise, you'll have a lot of Nirav Modis running away.
That's right. Yes. Mr. ASP Tripathi, our director of our Kanpur Institute, will ask a question. आप ये उसको ऑन करिए, अनम्यूट करिए, अनम्यूट
अनम्यूट.
थैंक यू सर. आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक मैम फॉर वेरी इनलाइटेड लेक्चर ऑन द सब्जेक्ट. एज अ मैटर ऑफ फैक्ट आई हैव नो क्वेरीज इन दिस रिगार्ड.
ओके. देन आई आस्क डॉक्टर पीसी सिंह. If PC Singh is around, a esteemed faculty member, colleague of ours. Is Dr. PC Singh around?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear. We can hear. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for such a detailed and good talk on a very relevant topic these days, development. I've got two very specific questions. First of all, these days there is a talk of, you see, greater role of private sectors. Can you tell me what is your perception about this? Once there is a greater role of private sector in Indian economy, which we cannot stop now. Everybody now all over the world, people are looking towards private sector. That's all right. Do you think that once private sector gets into all kind of things, in particularly in rural areas, the kind of works you have been watching and conducting, will it be affected? I mean, will it help the poor, or it will adversely affect them? Number one. And second, which is not part of your talk, but it is very relevant, ma'am. I just wanted to ask you, as I know you're from Kerala, when COVID spread in the beginning, everybody was talking of Kerala model, because Kerala successfully controlled it. But now there are cases going up in Kerala. I was talking to a friend of mine, but he also didn't, convincing answer to this. So that was the reason I wanted to ask you, what went wrong there in Kerala this time? Thank you.
You mean on the COVID case?
Yeah.
You're talking about COVID?
Yeah. Yeah.
Earlier, I think there was a stricter adherence to the rules and stricter enforcement. I think a little that, but that too much of persons coming from other infected areas and lack of that kind of vigilance and control led to the enormous increase. And then a few festivals, you know, the Onam and then the Christmas. I think these were two periods when suddenly the control was gone. And once the control was gone, it became difficult to track and bring it back into control. Generally, that's what I can say, because I have not been in Kerala and I do not know. Politically, of course, I would like to do well now, particularly with the elections being so close.
He had a first question about the role of the private sector.
The role of private sectors.
You see, earlier we found that no private and now education and health have become two most successful enterprises for the private sector. The city where I live, Coimbatore, every third place is either a medical shop or a clinic or a hospital. Everybody is into this business of healthcare services. There are so many diagnostic centers. There are so many clinics, so many hospitals. They're all thriving. And you feel sometimes, you know, you'll find so shabbily dressed villager take out bundles of notes from his not even pocket, you know, from the dhoti that he has tied around his waist. He'll pull out sheaves of notes, pay it across the counter to get the tests done. You can't go and ask him where did you get the money, but privately when you find out, you'll find they sold their property. They've done something to get the money because immediately they want to save a life. So there is some part of it is exploitation. Some part maybe the service needs that kind of money. Therefore, the government also is trying sometimes to keep a maximum charge on certain kind of investigations. Even for COVID and all that, they tried to control black marketing of some of the oxygen cylinders. They were being black marketed. You know, avarice is there. How can you control? And you cannot certainly order everybody to be morally right and morally good. I don't think that is within the powers of the government. Government can only say, all right, we'll punish people and punish. But there also, we are saying, look, they are punishing whomever they don't want. And they are letting free whoever they want to. These are all very tricky areas. But however, we have to depend on the government to keep vigil and make everything reachable to government. Like I was saying, you know, we don't have bus routes because private buses will not go into areas where there aren't enough persons to commuters to travel and pay them the money. So there will be areas which cannot be served. Then government have to take those non-profitable routes. Day in and day out, we see these this quarrel, you know, that buses are not available for people to commute because that route is not profitable for a private entrepreneur to run buses. Then government have to run buses there. So government has been stepping in wherever private sector is shy. Hitherto, education in the rural areas was such a sector. So only government schools went in, only government hospitals were there. But slowly now, private hospitals are also entering. You can see in a lot of areas, you know, English medium schools for children. And people are paying. You know, they're working hard. They're earning little more so that their child can go to an English medium school, learn so that it can have a better life later. It's a struggle. So you have to control the profit earning avarice of the private sector, particularly in these service sectors, no critical ones like education and health services.
Professor Jha? Please unmute.
Thank you very much, ma'am. You have enlightened us. I think there are so many models in the past we talked about. But this is just my query. This is not the question. Do you think since India's high growth is not accompanied by improvement in nutrition level of children, maternal mortality rate, and extreme poverty regions, so investment in the social sector, can we double it in the coming days, or it should be reduced in the name of infrastructure development? What is your opinion?
Please say it again. What should be doubled?
The social expenditure. The since India's high growth is not accompanied by improvement in nutrition level, because nutrition level is very low. Still, we are very lagging behind, and the hunger index is also very, very. Very deplorable, you can say. And so is maternal mortality rate. So, and we all have, we are not like Kerala. I am from Bihar, which is a very backward state. So I have seen the extreme poverty situation there over there. So extreme poverty reduction. So my question is, my query is, does this investment in the social sector be doubled or should be reduced for sake of infrastructural development?
Now, you said maternal mortality. Now, if we go into details of maternal mortality, one of the reasons is that in large part of the less developed areas, you do not have trained dies, midwives to deliver the babies. See, where there are institutional deliveries, maternal mortality is low. But where you do not have institutional deliveries, because of the lack of knowledge, lack of facilities and delays in conducting the delivery, the mother dies. One of the programs is training these midwives. I mean, suddenly you can't make a midwife, a dai, into a nurse. She can't go through all that 15-year education. But certainly, in the area where she is skilled of delivering the baby, she can be given advanced training. I think somewhere efforts are being made. That has got to be intensified in areas where other things will take a little more time to reach. See, one basic conclusion is with better education, people's health-seeking behavior improves. Then their maternal mortality is low. They can give better nutrition both to themselves and to the children. So anemia is one of the major causes of maternal mortality. So you're not giving nourishment to the pregnant woman. If you look at the chart and find out the various causes for maternal mortality, anemia stands out as the most important reason. That anemia can be overcome with nutrition education. Suddenly you can't make everybody literate like they made in Kerala, but certainly you can give everybody information and not knowledge about better nutrition, so that they can get rid of anemic conditions prevailing there. That is why we have all the Anganwadis. In Anganwadi, this is the basic emphasis. But if that Anganwadi is not run well, if that Anganwadi worker is not properly trained, if not, she's not properly supervised, that basic service. You know, we are supposed to have one Anganwadi for every 1,000 population. It is laid down. It has been utilized for the country. But if you don't put the right person and give her the minimum training that is required to deliver this basic service, she has got to. That area will be suffering. I think these are all doable things. And this can be, this requires certainly the civil society support, the support of that community. Awareness in community is very important. Therefore, you must place critical persons in Anganwadis, in the primary schools, with this basic information and knowledge so that they can spread it to the community around them. I'm sure we can improve the condition.
Nishant Bhai, Nishant.
Yes, sir. So, ma'am, thank you very much for this. The most amazing part of your lecture was like how some of the most complex, interdynamics or the complex relations when it comes to social work, you were able to highlight. And, I was receiving comments from some of my students that, you have explained it so, in a such a simplified manner that they were actually able to understand it and were very appreciative. So actually, I personally, instead of asking a question, I would like to give this opportunity to one of my students or one of our students at GEMC, Ankit Kanwar from Diploma, to ask his question. Ankit, if you can go forward and...
Our number is there?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
If you have any questions or query, then...
Let Nishant coordinate. No, if I think Ankit is presently, mute. If number, you have a question, please go ahead.
Sir, can I ask my question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Ma'am, like we all know that education is imperative for development of any country. But I come across a lot of students every day who feel that in our country, the education system is so stringent that it is not knowledge oriented. It is like a liability where students are bound by lots of strict rules and measures. So can there be a change in such policies, or the policy makers needs to think about this so that students can, bloom? And like we see in other countries, students are very much indulgent into tour and travel and sports and other extracurricular activities. But in our country, there are a lot of strict rules with which we are bound. So are these because of the policies made by the government of India, which cannot change these things, or can this be changed?
The education is something which has been studied most. There have been so many high level, national level commissions set up to write the education policy, to find out what is wrong with it and correct it. And all the time, there's so many recommendations. There is no dearth of recommendation, only the implementation is inadequate. And then not enough resources are provided.
Any other student?
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Giri, do you have a question for ma'am? You have to unmute yourself.
No, but thank you. I don't have a particular question. I enjoyed the talk as usual. So, ma'am, thank you so much. Yes.
Okay. Then, anyone else who wants to raise a question or a query or make a point?
I actually have Ankit's question, sir. Actually, he had sent me the question earlier. So, I have his question. And the crux of that question was that what he said that since India is a mixed economy and we do have a lot of welfare policies, and those are or have been in our priority list for a while. So will going or will transitioning towards a privatization, more and more privatization, will it result into a higher level of poverty? This was his, the crux of his question, man.
It need not, because people will go to what they can afford. Services are given both by the private sector. There must always be a public sector support. You can't, for instance, if you make all education private sector and no government schools at all, where will the poor children who cannot pay go to? Therefore, you need to have schools which can run without payment, like the government schools, so that those who can pay will go to private schools, pay any amount that private school is demanding according to what they can afford. So we need to have a mix. Some sectors we can't leave entirely to the private sector. Similarly, health.
Okay. Wow.
There are some issues. Ma'am, your video has gone up.
Yeah, I'm searching for it.
Okay.
Trying to get it back.
Okay, sure.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Any other question?
Yes, sir. Ritika has a question. Ritika, if you would like to, if you can go ahead and ask your question.
Yes, ma'am. I want to ask you that why is the quality of education deteriorating? And ma'am, why are students shifting towards private school despite so much of spending on government schools by the government?
Well, you see, the one reason which all the time everybody is aware and we're talking about is the quality of teachers. You know, if you have a good teacher, you learn better. And I would not say that all the teachers in the government schools have been exposed to adequate training. Though there have been several efforts made by government to train teachers even while on service. In-service training is there. There only trained teachers are taken. And the most sought out job is the teacher's job. And there are applicants in galore waiting in the Public Service Commission to get recruited as teachers. But you give proper training to the teachers, you cannot ensure that good quality teaching will happen. In the private sector, they pay more and most often they recruit people according to their capability. And therefore, sometimes the results in the private sector are better than in the public government schools. There are some cases where government schools also have done well, and the credit goes to the teachers.
I mean, some of the government schools now, teachers are much better paid than the private schools, many of the private schools.
But have the capacity been improved? Have they been given more training?
That's
salaries by one stroke of pen increases, but capacity won't increase that way. They have to go through training.
Thank you, ma'am, for your very extraordinary and powerful presentation. And we as an institute, our teachers, students have immensely benefited from your talk and would like to be guided by you and listen to your insights in the days to come. Thank you for coming, joining and delivering the lecture in a very short notice of 3 days. That was a greatness of yours. And we will certainly look forward and follow the developmental initiatives that you have been taking all over the country over the years. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you again.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I enjoyed talking to you all. And it's a good opportunity to remember all experiences and what same thing we could have done better if we were doing now again than the way we did it earlier.
Thank you. Okay.